introducing two people today. The first is my co-conspirator as the chairman of Hispanicize this year. He's the chairman and CEO of Republca, a good friend, and Jorge Plasencia today will be playing the role of interviewer for our very exciting guest. The second person, as you guys know, has been called by the New York Times and others the voice of Hispanic America. She's a writer, TV host, speaker, and perhaps the most recognized female broadcaster in this country. Her weekly syndicated column is published in 55 daily newspapers across the United States, and she's been the recipient of countless awards, including three national Emmys, one regional Emmy, and a Peabody Award for her work motivating Hispanics to participate in our political spectrum. She's a gifted storyteller, interviewer, and regularly commands audiences to the president and heads of state. You can see a rematch in Univision, as well as the news magazine show Aquí y Ahora. So please, with a warm Hispanicize 2012 welcome, help me introduce to the stage Maria Elena Salinas.
My sisters and I were all born in Los Angeles. And growing up in LA was really interesting because I never really felt like a minority. There's so many Latinos there, and I think it wasn't until after I was a teenager that I began to realize how important it was. I always felt that it was special to be a woman, but I didn't ever realize that it was my ethnicity, not only my gender, that made me special. Then I realized that how proud I am of my Hispanic heritage and how proud I am to be a Latina. And I first started merchandising, so I wanted to do what you do. I wanted to be in advertising, in marketing, and in public relations. And the twist of, yeah, I wanted to be you. I wanted to be what many of you are here. And then I got the bug when I was hired 31 years ago. 2 days ago, actually, it was my anniversary. April 9, 1981, I was hired at Camp 34 KMEX, and I swear I was 8 years old, and I'm telling you that story. I was just a little girl. And I think that's when I got the bug. That's when I realized, in the beginning, I thought, well, that's a good way for me to go into the sales department and get into advertising. But the minute I started working, I realized how important what my job was going to be. And it became an obsession for me. At that time, there were only 14 million Latinos in the country, now there's over 50 million Latinos. In LA, we, even though we were 25% of the population, we didn't have much political representation. That's one of the things I think that really marked what my mission would be as a journalist. And I remember, if I can give you a short anecdote, I think you talked to me, so I'm sorry, stop me if I'm talking to you. But we didn't have political representation. And I remember one time, it was maybe about 1983, when there was a possibility of a Latino being elected to the city council. And very excited, I went out and I interviewed people on the street. And out of 60 people I interviewed, 15 were not voting or didn't know about the election. And I thought, well, this is strange. I went back to my news director. And I told them, I can't do this story because people are not voting. He says, well, there's your story. There's an opportunity to have political representation and people are not voting. Why aren't they voting? Because they've been disenfranchised, because they haven't registered, because they're not citizens, because they don't care, because they don't
all
know.
These years later, that's still part of the
I business. Know it is, it is. But at that moment, I realized that one of the things that we needed to do because Latinos felt disenfranchised was to work on the giving power to the Latino community, the empowerment, the political empowerment of the Latino community. And that sort of became a mission. I understood then that not only my mission, but the mission of many of us who work in Spanish language media was to inform this vast community who was thirsty, who was hungry for information, not only to know their rights, but also to know their responsibilities in this country. And I think that's one of the things that marked my career early on.
But you've had a front row seat, literally. You've had a front row seat to watch the community grow from 40 million to over 50 million. How do you feel? Like, how does, you know, because those of us that know Maria Elena well know how humble she is, how genuine she is, how loving, how caring, what a good friend she is. But she's such a rock star. And, you know, sometimes, you know, when you're in the presence of a giant and you're close to that person, tend to forget. How has that been for you, having that front row seat for 25 years, to see the community go from 14 million to 50 million, and just to see a Supreme Court justice that's Latina now, to see mayors across the country developing governments that are Latina. There was even rhetoric out there about a vice presidential candidate that's
Latina.
It's right. Okay. But what can you say? What can you say? Tell us about that. I mean, we all want to know what's.
But thank you anyway. I think, you know, that's one of the things that makes me the most proud, to see how much the Latino community has grown, not only in quantity, like we said before, there's over 50 million, but in quality. Now you see more and more Latinos going to college, especially Latinas. You see more and more Latinos heading organizations and businesses and in political, important political positions, like you mentioned already. We have Supreme Court Justice, we have two senators, we have, I think it's 27, 28 Congress people, and on the local and state level, there are several. And I guess it's this sleeping giant that we've all been waiting to have to see waking up. And it's happening little by little, but I think we still have a long way to go. You know, it's sad when you say, yes, a million more people voted in the last, Latinos voted in the last election. And now Jalero is projecting that 2 million more Latinos will vote in the upcoming election in November. But I don't know if all of you know, but there are at least 8 million Latinos who are citizens who qualify to vote, who are over 18, and they're not registered. So why is that happening? We really need to motivate Latinos not to be apathetic, like I said before, to participate. But it really is makes me very proud to see how much we've grown and how much language television has grown. I remember when I started in Channel 34, one of those little regular stations that was always considered a station low quality, no viewership, that nobody watched except recently arrived immigrants. And people used to think of that working in Spanish language media was just a stepping stone for bigger and better things. And it's amazing to see how now we have grown so much that now we compete with English, our English language counterparts in cities like Miami, like Los Angeles, like New York, like Chicago, and how journalists that work in mainstream media, so-called mainstream media, are now moving over to Spanish language media. Why? Because we are the fastest growing, and because they understand that we reach people in a way that no one else can reach them. So I feel very proud to have seen this growth of Spanish language media and also of the community.
We're going to talk a little bit about yourself, your personal, just Maria Elena as a person. But I want to talk about, before we go there, I want to talk about, you know, you've interviewed, from, you know, my count, over a dozen presidents, from, you know, sitting U.S. presidents, like Carter, Bush, Clinton, Obama, to a number of Latin American presidents. How has that been for you to be able to kind of sit before these people and tell their stories about what's happening in their countries, what's happening in regard to domestic issues that for each one of these presidents is so important at that moment, obviously, at that moment in time. How is it, what responsibility do you feel when you're that person asking those questions and wanting to convey a message to all those Latinos that are watching you, that are trusting you, that are confiding in you? How does that make you feel?
I think, first of all, when you sit in front of a president or a newsmaker or a leader, someone who really holds power, it could be intimidating, but you know that you're there to do a job. And you sit and you prepare your questions, always thinking, what do people want to know? This person who is making decisions, the very important decisions, is affecting millions of people's livelihood. And I think that that's what I do. I sit and I think, what do people want to know? What is going to affect people? Sometimes it's not just about the question, it's about getting answers. And as any of you know politicians, you know that sometimes they answer what they want to answer and not necessarily what you ask them. So you always have to prepare and think of making sure that they give you that answer, so that you push your questions and you ask it again and again and again until you get those answers. And really, you know, sometimes some of the stories that have moved me the most in my career, in these 30 years that I've been working as a journalist, have not necessarily been these important people, these presidents, heads of states, people like Pinochet, people in Chile, people like Manuel Noriega from Panama, the presidents of Mexico, Zedillo, Fox, Calderón, Carlos Salinas de Gortari. But the interviews that I've done with ordinary people, everyday people who are affected by the decisions that these people make. And I think those are the types of stories that sometimes we need to bring out on our network to show how these people are affected and hope that the leaders will take notice and do something about it.
And the image that comes to mind is when you went down to Haiti.
When I went to Haiti, that was one of the most impressive things that I've ever done. You know, I've had the opportunity to cover wars, natural disasters, and it's always very impressive, but not as much as Haiti, because in Haiti, we saw so much destruction that even after spending a week in Baghdad, 3 weeks after the war had begun, I did not see so much suffering and so much destruction. And it was really, really sad, you know, and there's this unwritten rule that journalists have that you're not supposed to get emotionally involved in a story, but sometimes it's hard not to when you see suffering like this. You feel impotent, and the only thing that you can do is tell their stories and hope that somebody is watching and somebody will be compassionate enough to help.
Yes, Jorge.
Yes.
Yes, Jorge. Yes, Jorge is an effort that you've been carrying out for many years. Tell us about that. Tell us about the responsibility of getting Latinos out to vote, registering to vote. Tell us about that experience, because obviously it's been a very big effort that you have championed, the government of Latino and Univision.
Exactly. Yeah, this is something that I've been passionate about. Like I told you before, that the political empowerment of Latinos has been one of the most important things for me as the mission. Ya Estora is a program that unites LALEO, the National Association of Latino Elected and Appointed Officials, and Univision. And we have a series of events, not only public affairs announcements, public service announcements on all of our platforms, on television, on radio, on our website, but also with workshops in our different affiliates in cities all across the country. And the purpose of it is to make sure that people understand that, yeah, it's sort of, it's time, the time is now. This is when you have to make a decision to make a difference. We inform people not only why it's important to vote, but how. We give them all the mechanics so that there are no excuses why people should not go out and vote. And like I said, I'm happy to report that it has been very successful in the past. We have had great results when we see it. Sometimes, you know, it's hard to tell. Was it my message? Was it the message of NCLR? Was it the message of all the Latino organizations that are out there motivating Hispanics to register to vote? But if one or two or three or four people email me or tweet me, which is what people do now, and say, you know what, I saw your public service announcement, and I'm going to go and I'm going to register. You know that you made a difference in that person's life. And Arizona has big plans for 2012. Like I said, Naleo is projecting that 2 million more voters will go to this year to the polls in November, and we're hoping that's the way it's going to be. And we're using now more medium, now that we have the opportunity to reach more and more people through social media. So I'm very happy, and I think that we are going to get those results.
Well, that's a great segue to my next, and I don't mind you kind of making an announcement for today about the kind of 2.0 of the website. You were telling me about that, and I think that's super interesting, how you're actually going to start blogging.
Exactly.
And Maria Elena Salinas, well, that blogger now, to her many facets, which is very excited about this. So tell us about your vector columns, and your syndicated columns, and your syndicated across the country. But tell me about the new website.
Well, as many of you know, because I know that many of you here are bloggers, and you understand the importance of social media, I had a website for many years, and I was a syndicated columnist for 10 years with these features, and in my website, I wrote my columns would be published there, and pictures and some of the things that I do in my job. But I realized one day that I don't read the paper anymore. I get my website in the morning, I get my iPad in the morning, I sit down, have my coffee, and I read 10 newspapers instead of 2 newspapers that I was receiving at home. I read 10 newspapers. So I thought, you know what, I'm not going to write my column and publish it anymore. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use social media. So I decided to turn my website into a blog. And in about 2 weeks' time, more or less, I will put it out, the new version of it, not only with my columns and my blog, but also with articles from issues that I feel passionate about, issues such as immigration, education, women's issues, politics, Latino issues, both in English and in Spanish, because that's the reality now. Latinos are bilingual, 75% of Latinos have the choice of getting their media either in English or in Spanish, and I want to be able to reach both. That's why I do it in both languages. And because I also think that there are issues, one of the reasons why Latinos watch us at Univision, for example, is that not only the language, but the content, the issues. And there are very few places where Latinos can go and find out about things that affect them, that affect their daily lives, that interest them in their daily lives. So that's why now, besides being a journalist, journalist and author, I'm going to be a blogger. That's the point. And a mom, of course. Not going to be a blogger.
She was telling me she would love to meet a lot of the bloggers that are here after, so we stop by the press conference, which would be great. But I was talking about author, you wrote a very a conversation. Why don't you do that outside of this room? You know, so we can kind of pay attention to this very important topic. Thank you. You wrote a book about your father. You wrote a book about your father that was game changing for you, I think personally, and that was game changing just for the Latino community with the issue you wrote about. I'd love you to talk to us about Yo Soy La Hija de Mi Padre, I Am My Father's Daughter, and kind of the journey that took you to writing that book, which, by the way, is available on Amazon. Tell us about
Yo Soy La Hija de Mi Padre, una vida sin secretos, I Am My Father's Daughter, Living a Life Without Secrets. This is a book that I originally thought of for the 25th anniversary of Univision, and I thought, well, this is going to be a book about my career, and a book about how language television has grown hand-in-hand with the Latino community, and how I have grown hand-in-hand with both. But I wanted to put my personal story into it, and the more I researched about my family life and my background, I realized that the book needed to be about my father. When my father passed away in 1985, I found out a big secret, and I found out that he had been a priest. I did not know that while he was alive. One of his friends brought me a box at Channel 34 of documents, and in those documents there was a small pamphlet of my uncle's anniversary as a priest, and inside that pamphlet he thanked those who contributed to his vocation, and my father's name was there, Reverend Jose Luis Cordero Salinas. And of course, that's a shock. It would be a shock to anyone. I didn't understand what was going on there. I didn't understand why he never told us. I didn't understand why he kept that secret, why my mother never told us, and what effect it had in my life. So I went into a journalistic investigation on my own background, and the more I found out, the more I realized that I really didn't hear a lot of things about my dad. And one of the things I inherited was his social conscience. It's who that came out a little bit also. So I combined this book because with my career and with the growth of Spanish language television, because really it was throughout my career that my personal life connected with it. You know, it's funny, but I didn't know my family. I didn't know my father's family, and I always thought that my life was like a novela because my father came from a very exclusive family in Mexico City, and my mother came from a little town in Mazatlán. And like the novelas, you know, there's always he wasn't necessarily a very wealthy man, but he did come from a well-to-do family, and he married a very poor girl. So I figured that he had been disowned, and that's why he didn't know the family. And when I found out that my father was a priest, I thought, well, maybe this changes a lot. Maybe that's the reason why I don't know my family. And little by little, I ran into them working. I went to interview Sevilla one day, and one of the gentlemen that was there, he said, hello, I'm your cousin. That's strange, you're my cousin? He's my cousin. I mean, I thought he was joking because his last name might have been Salinas. He said, yes, my grandmother was Maria Elena Salinas, my great aunt was Maria Elena, they named you after her, and my great uncle was Jose Luis, your father. When I saw his eyes, he looked like my father, I realized to tell me the truth, and it was very difficult to do an interview with a presidential candidate, as you can imagine, when I just got this news about finding my long-lost family, and the next day he organized a dinner with several members of my family, and that I got to meet. So it's funny how this career has really opened up so many things for me that I was even able to find my family. One of the reasons why I thought that this was an important message for the Latino community is because the part of the book, of course, of the growth of Spanish language television and some of the stories that I've covered throughout my career were important for me to share. But also my personal story, because I think probably every single person in this room has a story to tell about a secret in their family, whether it's their father, their mother, their uncle, their cousin, someone who kept a secret back home and never revealed that secret. And I think sometimes those secrets build an invisible wall that doesn't allow us to have a closer family relationship. And I thought that maybe it would help some people to shed some of those secrets and to live a much closer family life and understand your heritage well and be proud of that heritage.
Well, I think that deserves a round of applause. I'd love to switch over to Julia and Gabby, which are your pride and joy. I've personally seen them grow up into two amazing young ladies. I know you just got back from a trip to Machu Picchu.
Yes, you're on vacation.
You're in Peru. Tell us about, Maria Elena, the mom, that I know comes first and foremost.
Right, that's the most important job.
And I know how difficult it is for you sometimes.
That's probably the most important
part. We have a lot of mommy bloggers here.
Yeah, that's what it was. They understand that that's the most important part of our job. First, being a mother, and second, being a mother and a professional at the same time and finding that balance, especially if you're a single mom with two teenage girls. Boy, that's tough. 14 and 17. So if any of you have teenage kids, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's not easy. But, you have to deal with the guilt, first of all. When you have to go to work, especially in my job where you have to travel quite a bit, and you feel guilty giving your kids. You feel guilty not being there for them in those very special moments that sometimes you have to miss. But at the same time, you're doing a service to your children because you're showing them that there are a lot of possibilities out there for them. That you can be in a career that maybe some people might think had been reserved for men. Or a career that really takes you all around the world, and a career especially in which you can make a difference in people's lives. I have told my daughters that over and over again, and it's funny because there's a chapter in my book called "Be a Work Mom," because ever since they were little, when I would come home from a store from traveling, and the first thing they would ask me is, "Do you have work, Mom? Do you have to go to work?" And yes, I have to go to work that same day. They would always be sad about it. You know, all these years later, they still ask me when I come back from a trip, "Do you have work?" And the little one especially has always said, "Why do you have to go? Why can't four your mamas go? Why can't you go?" And, they were old enough to understand. I sat them down and I explained to them, "Look, this is my job. This is what I do. And yes, it's true that Jorge can also go. But it's a privilege for your mom to be able to cover the same types of stories that Jorge can. And to be able to do in interviews that are as important as the ones that Jorge does. That's why we want to make sure that we are at the same level. In order for me to be able to stay at the same level, I have to do this work." One time I was going to interview Bill Richardson, when he was going to announce that he was going to be running for president. And that was one of those times when my daughter said, "Mom, why can't you your mom's go?" So I explained to her, "I'm going to go interview someone that could potentially be the president of the United States." And they gave me the exclusive interview. They gave your mom the interview. They think that I am important enough to be able to get that message to the Latino community. I think she understood, and she wrote me a big, big card that she had folded, and she put inside the card, "Mom, I hope you have a nice trip, and that you inform and influence a lot of people." And I thought that was something very, very special because I thought, well, she's very young. She must have been maybe 8 years old at the time. I have to do the math to try to figure out how many years ago that was, but more or less at 8, and I thought she understands, and the message has come through, and I'm taking them both to stories that I have covered so that they understand, and so that they themselves have goals in life, so that they, when it comes time to choose a career, that they realize that it can be done. Growing up, I always thought that being a working mom was a piece of cake. I used to see my mom, she was a seamstress, and she made it look effortless. We never felt that there was anything missing in our home. We weren't cheated out of our time, so I thought, that's easy. When I'm a working mom, it'll be easy. But really, it's not. It's a lot of work. It's very hard. It's very challenging. I think that all of us probably have a lot of more respect for our mothers when we begin working and we become working mothers ourselves.
That's for sure. As we start closing, I just want to ask you, the community is going through such a exciting time. And there's so much greatness happening about the Hispanic community today. You know, and we talked about what's happening on the political side, on the bench. Where do you see Spanish language media going? I know Univision recently announced its Tumblr, its English language Tumblr. You talked about how we're living in both worlds, how we're totally bilingual. You know, I don't really know what we call it cross-cultural. You know, we're in these two worlds. Where do you see it going?
I think it's going to stay in these two worlds, but at the same time with a bigger purpose for Latinos. Because, like I said before, we're not only growing in numbers, we're going to continue to grow in numbers. We'll be 30% of the population by the year 2050, according to projections. But we are a very young community. So the future of this country really is in the hands of the youth. I do see Spanish language media continuing to grow and continuing to develop like it has. You know, when I first started working way back then, people used to tell me, why don't you make a translation to English? You know, there's no future in Spanish language media. People are going to assimilate it. They won't speak Spanish anymore. And, you know, 50 years later, I'm sorry, not 50 years later. 30 years later.
A few.
30 years later, you know, they were partly right because, yes, the Latino community has assimilated, but where they were wrong is in thinking that assimilation means leaving behind your culture and your language. And it doesn't. It means adding on another language. And Latinos have acculturated and assimilated. They will continue to do that. If you see the growth of Hispanics, it's not so much immigration now, it's U.S. born. And we still have a lot of challenges as a community. One of the biggest challenges, of course, is educating our youth. We're a very young community, medium age, 26 years old. We have many school districts where we are the majority. And there's still a lot of concern there because we still have the highest dropout rate. But I'm so proud of another program, of Este Momento, another program that Univision has, and all the efforts that I see every single day, so many organizations making sure that Latinos are educated. And it's not only for them and their families and their communities, but for the country, because they are the future of this country, and we do not want to leave the future of this country in the hands of uneducated people. So for that reason, I think that I personally have put my money where my mouth is, and I have a scholarship, the Maria Elena Salinas scholarship that I've had for 11 years now, and I'm very happy to announce that a lot of my scholarship recipients are already working in the media. We have at least one who is a news director in North Carolina. We have several that are reporters, and that's where I see that we can make a difference by educating our youth. So I think that's one of the biggest, that's one of the biggest challenges I think that we have right now as a community is educating our youth and making sure that the future of this country is in the hands of educated.
You know, you mentioned this at Momento, and we've been a part of that, and we do focus groups across the country. And as we spoke to children across the country, dropouts, specifically in Los Angeles, they said part of the reason why I'm dropping out is not to get it again. It's because I have to provide for my mom. I have to provide for my home. So it's very interesting. A lot of those kids are now going back and getting a GED. So it's very interesting, the shift that is happening. And again, you have a front row seat to see that. You know, to close, Maria Elena, you know, you've done so much. But every time I talk to you, it feels like you don't feel like you've done enough.
That's true. Yes. Why?
Why is it? Because I think in this room, there's a lot of us that feel that way. There's a lot of us that, wow, you know, throughout our careers, we've done some great things. But we wake up every morning knowing or feeling that there's still so much to do. And I think you're there 25 years later in that anteroom. Why?
There is. Yesterday I was in New York and I was on a panel talking about women and what motivates women and the challenges that women have. And there was someone asked us about mentors. You know, who's your mentor and what inspires you? And one of the girls gave a really interesting answer. She says, you know, it's not about having a mentor or one mentor or two mentors. It's about keeping all those advice in your mind since you're a little girl. There's always something that someone tells you growing up. It could be a friend, it could be a teacher, it could be your parents. There's so many different people in your lives that give you a bit of advice or just say certain phrases that stick to you and really make a difference in your life when you grow up. In my case, two of those phrases were, don't allow yourself to be mediocre, and don't be a conformist. And another one that always came from my father is, you never stop learning, you never stop growing, never stop reading. And I think that's what has set my life. You know, I don't want to settle. I don't want to be a conformist. I definitely do not want to allow myself to be mediocre. And I want to continue to grow and learn every single day. Sometimes people ask, well, how does it feel to be at the peak of your career? So, well, I'm not at the peak of my career. Because when you reach the top, there's two things that you can do. If you've reached on the top, you have to start going down, or you have to hang on with your nails to stay there and not fall. So I prefer to think that I have not reached the top. One of the fascinating things about this career is that every single day there's a new challenge, there's a new event to cover, a new historic event to witness, a new person to interview, a new technology to conquer and learn. So there's still Maria Elena Salinas for a while, I hope, but that's it. And I hope a lot of you feel the same way.
Of this work event, because you are our first innovator at Hispanicize, and you will be getting a very pretty trophy that you will take home with you. You can tell your daughters and you can tell them that all of that blood, sweat, and tears was not a thing. It was because you did it for them, you did it for 50 million people that you carried.
No, I'm definitely honored to receive this award, and you know, it's interesting. Latinovator, when a lot of people were congratulating me and saying, oh, that's great, you're giving them an award, Latinovator. What's a Latinovator? And you know, I talked to Emilio Stefan a few weeks ago because he's also receiving this award, just like Cesar Millán, and they're both dear friends and I love them very much. And I said, why are we receiving this award, Emilio? He said, you know why? Because there'll be a lot of record producers, but there will never be another Emilio Stefan. And there will be a lot of journalists, but there will never be another you, so you should be proud of who you are. And I am proud of who I am, but more than anything else, I'm proud of my heritage. So, I mean, I wish that just for today I could change Latino Vader to Latina Vader. Because I really want to share this with a lot of the Latinos. And knowing that I'm the first woman to receive this award. And in this day and age where there's a lot of talk out there about what should we call ourselves? Are we Hispanic? Are we Latinos? Are we Mexican American or Cuban American? Well, now we can add, at least I can proudly say that I am a Mexican American Latino Vader. So that's my new title.
Personally, I'll never forget this. We've come a long way, and I thank Manny and Hispanicize for the opportunity to do this. I was honored to do it, and obviously, you will continue to hear a lot more about Manny and Salinas in the years to come, because as you heard from her, you ain't seen like it yet. So thank you all for your attention, and I appreciate the attentiveness. And I know that there's a lot going on, a lot of tweeting, a lot of energy in the room. I thank you all, and now the moment.
Thank you very much. And if I could just leave you with one thought, and
that's
being very proud of who you are, very proud of your cultural heritage, and pass it on to your kids. I think that's one of the most important things that we can do as a legacy, is to give our kids the pride in our cultural heritage.